are junction transistors. They are called as BJT. Field effect transistors, FET. This BJT is once again classified into two types, NPN, NPN, PNP, NPN transistor, PNP transistor. Coming to FETs, classified into two categories, junction field effect transistor, junction field effect transistor, metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor. Once upon a time, the last 10 years back, there are more number of questions on BJT. But if you see the last 4 or 5 years, there are more number of questions on MOSFET. That's why we'll concentrate more on the MOSFET. Yes, we'll cover the BJT, then we'll cover the JFET, then we'll come to the MOSFET, but we are going to do more number of problems and we'll concentrate more on the MOSFET. And if there is a MOSFET question, that means, if you see previous papers, continuously there are two questions, common data. Data will be same, he's asking two questions. That's why we have to concentrate more on the MOSFETs. Okay? But I think most probably it will come in the tomorrow's session, MOSFETs. If you want to understand the MOSFET, JFET is basic. Okay? That's why first see the JFET, then we'll see this thing. Okay? Next. Once again, JFET is classified into N-channel JFET, P-channel JFET, okay, N-channel JFET and P-channel JFET. Depletion MOSFET, enhancement MOSFET. Yeah, before going for further, there is a one more question somebody raised. Okay, we'll solve it later. Yeah, we'll continue with this thing. MOSFET, depletion MOSFET, enhancement MOSFET. Depletion MOSFET once again classified into N-channel depletion MOSFET, P-channel depletion MOSFET. This enhancement MOSFET once again classified into N-channel enhancement MOSFET, P-channel enhancement MOSFET. N-channel enhancement MOSFET and P-channel enhancement MOSFET. So first we'll start with the bipolar junction transistor. Bipolar junction transistor, in short form it is called transistor or BJT. It is a three terminal semiconductor device, three terminal semiconductor device. The terminal names are emitter, base, collector. And there are two types of transistors, NPN and PNP. If we see structure, it's emitter, base, collector. Assume this is PNP. Similarly, an NPN transistor, it's NPN, it's collector, base, emitter. Okay, BJT is a three-terminal semiconductor device. The terminal names are emitter, base, collector, and there are two types of bipolar junction transistors, NPN transistor and PNP transistor. This is the structure of an PNP transistor, this is structure of an NPN transistor. Coming to symbol, this is the symbol of the NPN transistor. Emitter, base, collector. Always the arrow mark will be on the emitter terminal. Always the arrow mark will be on the emitter terminal. If arrow mark is in the outward direction, then it is called NPN transistor. If arrow mark is inside that one, inside to the transistor, then it is PNP transistor. Once again I am repeating, if the arrow mark is in the outward direction, then it is called NPN transistor. If arrow mark is inside, then it is called PNP transistor. What is that arrow mark indicates? Conventional current direction. Current direction when emitter base junction is forward biased. Emitter base junction is forward biased. What? Where is that emitter base junction? Okay. This junction, this is emitter, this is base. Therefore, this junction is called emitter base junction. This junction is called collector base junction. This junction, same, emitter base junction. This junction is called collector base junction. So arrow mark indicates conventional current direction. That's nothing but a current direction when emitter base junction is forward biased. Now comes to the next one. Doping wise, emitter is heavily doped. Emitter is heavily doped. Collector is moderately doped. Base is lightly doped. Now why it has to be like this? Before going to see why it is heavily doped, moderately doped, lightly, we'll see first why it is called emitter, base, collector. Emitter, the name itself suggests emitter. It supplies, what it supplies? Charge carriers. What charge carriers? If it is a PNP transistor, it will supply the holes. If it is an NPN transistor, it will supply the electrons. So either it will supply the electrons or it will supply the holes. That's why we will say call it as supply the charge carriers. Clear? Collector. Why it is so called collector? It collects the charge carriers which are emitted from the or which are emitted by the emitter. So emitter will supply the charge carriers, collector will collect the charge carriers. Clear? The next one, base. Base simply transports the charge carriers from emitter to collector. Some of the charge carriers may recombination take in place. That we'll see in the while explaining the operation, that we'll see. Clear? So emitter will supply the charge carriers, collector will collect the charge carriers, base simply transports the charge carriers from emitter to collector. Now why emitter has to be heavily doped? If heavily doped means more number of charge carriers are available. More number of charge carriers are available means it can able to supply more number. Heavily doped means it can able to supply more number of charge carriers. Either electrons or holes, that depends on either a PNP transistor or NPN transistor. Then, why base is lightly doped? Simply base has to transport the charge carrier from emitter to collector. If it is heavily doped, now see here, N-type semiconductor, electrons are majority carriers, electrons are flowing from here to here. Electrons are coming. Now here, there are, it's heavily doped, assume. If it is heavily doped, that means more number of holes will be available. So more number of electrons and holes will recombine. So the number of electrons that are received at the collector are reduced. Collector current will be reduced. Okay. Therefore, base has to be lightly doped so that the base recombination current, the recombination that are happening in the base should be small. So then why we have to, why we require base? Simply remove base. Okay, remove base. We reduce the recombination, means if you remove the base, it becomes zero recombination. Then all electrons will be reached to the collector or not. The electrons which are emitted by the emitter will be reached to the collector. Thing is, let us suppose we remove this one. Then this N-type becomes N-type semiconductor. So it is not going to perform the transistor action. The base is controlling the current. Controlling is possible. Whereas if you remove base, all electrons will reach to the collector, which are emitted by the emitter. Then there is no controlling. If you want to control, simply by using the base terminal, we can control the output current. Controlling is possible. Thus, I will give the later session comparison between diode and BJT. Why you have to go for a transistor, even though first we are having diode. Diode is also a semiconductor device. Why you have to go for transistor? That I will give later sessions. Okay? Most probably at the end of today or tomorrow it will come. Clear? Now, why collector should be moderately doped? It can also be lightly doped. Okay, if it is heavily doped, what is the problem? Recombination increases. Okay? That's problem. The number of electrons reaching to the collector terminal will be reduced because in the collector region, more recombination taken place if it is heavily doped. At the same time, repulsion comes, resistivity increases. That's another one. Now, why it is moderately doped means sigma conductivity. It should have more conductivity. Sigma equals to, we have to see, N mu N E. Okay? If it is lightly doped, this value is very small, then conductivity is very small. We require conductivity, large conductivity. If you want large conductivity, N should be very high. If N is very high, then already said recombination increases. Okay? That not recombination, sorry, repulsions. More number of electrons comes into this one, repulsion increases. Repulsion forces are going to increase. That means they will move in a random directions. Net current once again will reduce. Therefore, the collector should be moderately doped such that conductivity existed, repulsion forces also less. The next one. Area wise, collector is having large area, base is having small area, emitter is having moderate area, average. Why base is having small area? Whatever the charge carriers emitted by the emitter, immediately it has to reach to the collector. When it is possible, the base width must be as thin as possible. Clear? So base should be very small. Now collect, why emitter should have moderate one? Okay? If it is increasing that size, then the transistor size is going to increase. If it is small, it has to supply more number of charge carriers. Area available for the charge carriers is reduced. Therefore repulsion forces increase. Therefore moderate is selected. Why collector should have larger area? See here, this collector base junction is reverse bias. Emitter base, generally, I will give that one. Collector base junction is reverse bias. That means the voltage drop here is more. Current will be there, voltage will be there. So power dissipation will be increases. Power dissipation is in the form of heat. More heat will be generated the collector junction. More heat will be generated at the junction. If you are not able to dissipate it to the surroundings, then the device is going to heated. Heated means it's going to damage. Already I said each electronic device is capable of withstanding certain maximum temperature. If you go beyond that one, it is going to damage. So whatever the heat generated here, it has to be dissipated to the surroundings immediately. Otherwise the problem comes. for that purpose, the power dissipation is directly proportional to area. If you are having more area, more it can be dissipated to the surroundings. This increase also up to certain extent. Beyond that one means the size of the transistor is further increases. That's one second problem. That's why you are going for a heat sink. Heat sink. Now another example, let us suppose you have seen your processor. You know, your computer, CPU, processor is there. For a processor, one fan is attached. Why that fan is attached? See, in a processor, millions of transistors are there. Each transistor is dissipating a small power. Millions of transistors combinedly dissipating so much power. Power dissipated is increasing means it is in the form of heat. That means processor is going to be heated. So that heat, what the fan is going to do is, it's acting like an exhaust fan. It collects the heat from the processor and it will dissipate it to the surroundings. Let us suppose remove the fan, it immediately, within a minutes or some time, the processor is going to be heated and it's damaged permanently. That's why the processor is important for the, the fan is very much important for the processor. Clear? It is acting as a heat sink. It will collect the heat from the processor and it will dissipate it to the surroundings. Clear? That's why collector should have larger area. Now, construction. How to construct a transistor? Either NPN transistor or PNP. Take a PNP transistor. For that one, take a P-type semiconductor. Add N-type impurities in between. It's not P-type, N-type, P-type combiningly you will get PNP transistor. No. Take a P-type semiconductor, add N-type impurities in between. Otherwise, take an N-type semiconductor, add P-type impurities. Otherwise, take a silicon, add N-type impurities, N-type impurities either side, add P-type impurities in between NPN transistor, you are going to get it. Okay. We have seen symbol, we have seen structure, okay. Then we have seen this one. BJT is having two PN junctions, okay, we have already seen. This is, one is called emitter base junction, second one is called collector base junction. If you see now the structure like this, already I said it's emitter base collector, it's an NPN transistor assume. This is called emitter base junction, this is called collector base junction. Okay, this is one NPN, one PN junction and another PN junction. If you take one PN junction, either it can be forward bias or reverse bias. It is two PN junctions are there, means how many possible combinations will get it? Four possible combinations. Okay, so this is, take it as emitter base junction, this is, take it as collector base junction. Both can be forward bias, then the transistor is said to be in the saturation mode. Current will be maximum. Applications acts as a on switch. Emitter base junction forward bias, collector base junction also forward bias, then the mode of operation is called saturation. In the saturation, current will be maximum. Applications is on switch. Both are reverse biased. Okay. That mode of operation is called cutoff. Current is nearer to zero. And it is acting as off switch, acting as off switch. Forward bias, reverse bias. Forward bias, reverse bias. Then the transistor is said to be in the active region. Then output current is proportional to input current linearly. Output current is proportional to input current linearly. Acts as an amplifier. Acts as an amplifier. This is reverse bias. This one is forward bias. Then it is called inverse active. Inverse active. Here output current decreases and it is acts as a attenuator. It's out as input current increases, output current decreases. Therefore it's called attenuator, inversely proportional, output current and input current. Acts as attenuator. This mode of operation we are never going to use. Simple RC circuit also acts as an inverter. So there is no need of going for an active device such as BJT. BJT is an active device which can able to generate the energy. Okay. Now, the most commonly used application of BJT is an amplifier. When it will act as an amplifier, if emitter base junction is forward bias, collector base junction is reverse bias. You see most of the circuits, if there is a transistor is there, 99.99% cases, emitter base junction will be forward bias, collector base junction will be reverse bias, so that it acts as a linear device, it's nothing but it performs the amplification. Whereas in these two combinedly acts as a switch. In one case it is acting as an on switch, in another case it is acting as a off switch. Now we are going for the operation of a PNP transistor or NPN transistor. Whatever, I'll explain. That's operation of PNP transistor. Whatever I'm explaining for a PNP transistor, same thing holds good for NPN transistor also. The only thing is if I am using here word hole means there it in NPN becomes electron. Here if I am using the word electron, there it becomes hole. If I am said here something positive, there it will be negative. Here I said something negative, there it becomes positive. Exactly opposite. Clear? The next one. Now the question is, if you see some problems, I think we have seen current is negative, minus I equals to minus 5 milliamperes. Current can be negative any time. We see in signals and systems, frequency is negative. Frequency negative, how it is possible? Similarly, current in EDC circuits, how current can be negative? Here negative in the sense, actual direction and the reference direction are opposite to each other. Okay, I'll explain. Okay, that you can understand. Consider it is a PNP. It is emitter terminal, it is base terminal, it is collector terminal. Okay, always this is reference directions always is assumed to be entering into the device. Now here we are taking a transistor. This IE, IB, IC are reference directions, nothing but assumed direction. Now we'll calculate what is the actual direction. If actual direction also in the same direction, then current IE will be positive. Else, if current is flowing in the direction, then IE will be negative. So first of all, we have to take a reference direction. Always it is taken that compulsory. Reference direction is entering into the device, whether it's a BJT, whether it's a FET or whether it's a UJT or any device. Always the reference directions are entering into the device. Now we'll see the what is the actual direction. That's second. Okay. Now this is called emitter base junction. This emitter base junction has to be forward bias or reverse bias. It has to be forward bias. Forward bias means it's a p-type semiconductor has to be connected to higher potential. This one is connected to be lower potential. This is base.
it's gone.
Okay. So this emitter base junction is forward bias. This is called VEB. VEB. Comes to this one. Collector base junction has to be, this junction has to be reverse bias. Reverse bias means P has to be connected to negative terminal. This is called VCB. Okay. Now first of all, VEB is positive or negative for a PNP transistor. For a PNP transistor, VEB is positive or negative. That means here VEB positive means emitter is at higher potential than the base. See here, emitter is at higher potential, base is at lower potential, therefore VEB has to be positive. Now VCB positive or negative, take it as positive. That means collector has to be at higher potential than the base. See here, collector is at lower potential than the base. That means this one is wrong. This is VCB is negative. That means collector is at lower potential than the base. Positive means emitter is at higher potential than the base. Here collector is at lower potential than the base. This is the meaning of VEB positive, VCB negative. Now we are applying a forward bias operation. How a BJT works or a PNP transistor works. This emitter base junction is forward bias means here this PN junction is forward bias. What is going to happen? Holes are moving like this. Holes are moving this like this means this is IP. This is IP. Now, similarly, this PN junction is forward bias. Holes are moving from here to here. Electrons are moving from here to here or not? Electrons are moving here to here means what is the current direction? This direction, IN. And this is indicated by IPE, this is indicated by INE. What is the meaning of this thing? This is the whole current in emitter, or whole current due to, what we can say, whole current in emitter junction. Electron current across the emitter junction. This is called emitter base junction or emitter junction. So, if you apply forward bias, holes will move from here to here. That current is given by IPE. Holes are coming from emitter, therefore IPE. Similarly, because of forward bias, electrons are moving from here to here. Electrons are moving from here to here means current direction is like this. Therefore, this is INE. Clear? Therefore, apply KCL at this node. IE is entering, IPE is leaving, INE is leaving. Therefore, applying KCL. Apply KCL at node P. What is going to happen? IE is equals to IPE plus INE. Equation number one. Now see here, this is heavily doped, this is lightly doped. Lightly doped means the number of electrons available in this region are very less. Number of electrons available in this region are very less means can INE negligible or not? The number of electrons moving from here to are negligible compared to the number of electrons moving from here to here. That means INE is negligible. Once again I am repeating. Apply KCL at this node, IE is entering, these two are leaving, that's why IE equals to IPE plus INE. This is heavily doped, that means more number of holes are available, therefore IPE is a large quantity. Whereas this base is lightly doped. Lightly doped means the number of charge carriers available are very small. Here the number of charge carriers, electrons available are very small, therefore the number of electrons moving from here to here are very small compared to number of electrons moving from here to here are very small compared to number of holes moving from here to here. That means INE is negligible or not. Therefore this IE is approximately equals to IPE if you neglect INE. That's first point, mathematical things. Comes to theoretical thing. Yeah. Now let us suppose 100 holes are moving from here to here. This 100 came here. What is going to happen here? N-type semiconductor existed. It is lightly doped. Let us suppose there are less number of electrons are layer existed. Less number is existed. But from here to here 100 is coming. This out of this 100, some of the holes will recombine with the electrons available in this one. Electrons available in this one. Out of 100, let us suppose 5% recombines. 5 electrons are recombined with 5 holes. So remaining how many? 95 holes are received by the collector terminal. Why it is receiving the, this is a reverse bias. Reverse bias holes are your minority carriers. The reverse bias will allow the minority carriers. Holes are coming from here to here. Once it comes, it becomes a minority carriers, not quantity wise. Okay? In N-type semiconductor, holes are minority carriers. The reverse bias will allow the minority carrier. These holes will be attracted by the collector terminal. Okay? Therefore, this is IPC. Now, what is IPC then? IPC equals to the number of holes received 100 minus recombination. How many recombination is we have assumed? 5%. Okay. So this is the current received at the collector terminal, or holes received at the collector terminal, that is given by IPC. Clear? What is this meaning of this thing? Hole current in collector terminal or at the collector terminal, hole current at the emitter terminal, electron current at the emitter terminal or emitter base junction. It's clear. Once again I am repeating, 100 holes are moved from here to here. Out of those 100 holes, some of the holes will recombine with the existing electrons in N-type semiconductor. Since N-type semiconductor is lightly doped, therefore number of electrons available are very less, assuming 5% recombination taking place. Therefore 95 holes are received by the collector terminal. So now collector current is due to these 95 holes. At the same time, now see, okay. This collector base junction is reverse biased or not? Reverse bias means minority carriers will move or not? Here in P-type semiconductor, minority carriers are electrons. Electrons will move here or not? Electrons are moving here means some reverse saturation current will be there or not? That reverse saturation current is denoted as IC0, and it is taken like this. And it is taken like this. This is once again assumed direction. Okay? We'll see the actual direction. Clear? This is once again assumed direction of reverse saturation current. Why reverse saturation current existed? Because reverse collector base junction is reverse bias. We know we represented reverse saturation current as IO, I suffix O. But here there are two PN junctions are there, emitter base junction, collector base junction. Now this reverse saturation current at the emitter base junction or collector base junction? It is at the collector base junction. Therefore it is denoted as ICO. That means it is a reverse saturation current at the collector terminal, collector junction. So this is the reference direction. Now we'll find out the directions. What is the direction? IE, current in due to electrons in emitter holes is flowing in this direction, current due to electrons are flowing in this direction. That means total current is equals to this direction. And this one are in the same direction or not? Okay, like this. It is also going like this. Therefore, IE will be positive. IE is positive in the sense, once again, this is the reference direction. Actually, holes are moving in this direction, electrons are coming in this direction, therefore current direction due to electrons is this one. So total current in emitter terminal across the emitter junction is in this direction. This is the reference direction, actual direction also in the same direction, therefore IE is positive. Next comes, see here, IC is entering in this direction. IC is coming in the direction. Holes in the collector terminal is coming in this direction. Therefore, current direction is this direction. Current direction is, actual current direction is this direction. Reference direction is this direction. Reference is this one. Actual direction is this one. Both are in the opposite direction. Therefore, IC is negative. IC is negative. Always IC and IB will be in the same. The fundamental rule is IE and IC will be in the opposite direction. If this is positive means compulsory this has to be negative. If this is negative means this is positive. The other rule is IC and IB will be in the same direction always. Okay. Next. What is the reverse saturation current? I have taken reverse current in this direction. This is the reference direction. But minority carriers here. Minority carriers here are electrons. Electrons are flowing in this direction. Electrons are flowing in this direction. What means, what is the reverse saturation current? In this direction. This direction and this direction are opposite. Therefore, IC naught is negative. IC naught is negative. This holds good for PNP transistor. If you are coming for an NPN transistor, exactly opposite. Okay, the next thing. See here, base current. Base current is how much? Nothing but recombine. 100 volts are coming here, 5 are recombined, 95 are received. So what is the base current is due to? 5 volts recombined with 5 electrons. 5 volts recombined with 5 electrons will give you recombination current, nothing but base current. So base current is due to recombination of charge carrier that is taking place in the base. What is the value? IPE minus IPC. Here 100 volts are coming from emitter. 95 are received. So how many recombined? 5. So current is due to this, current in the base is due to that 5 recombination current. Therefore this thing. Okay. Therefore this is IB equals to IPE minus IPC. It's clear? Now. Transistor is having 3 parameters. Their first one is called emitter efficiency. Emitter efficiency. It is denoted as gamma. It is given as gamma equals to IPE by IE. The total number of holes at the emitter terminal, emitter junction divided by total emitter current. What is total emitter current? IPE by IPE plus INE, which is gamma is less than 1 or not always, because see this one, beta gamma is always less than 1, emitter efficiency. The second one is transport factor beta star. Transport factor. How efficiently the base is transporting the charge carriers, beta star. It is the holes received at the collector terminal by the holes transmitted from the emitter terminal. So IPC by IPE. That is called beta star. Then large signal current gain. Large signal current gain. It is denoted as alpha, one of the important parameter for us, alpha. The alpha equals to output current, that is IPC by input current IE. Alpha equals to IPC by IE. So it's IPC by IE. This can be written as IPC by IPE, IPE by IE. What is IPC by IPE? IPC by IE here. See, IPC by IE. Beta star. Beta star. What is IPE by IE? IPE, yeah, IPE by IE. It's gamma. The relationship between transistor parameters is alpha equals to beta star into gamma. Alpha is called large signal gain. Beta star is called transport factor. Gamma is called emitter efficiency. Now, see, this is always less than this one. Once again, alpha value also less than 1 always. And nearer to 1. They are nearer to 1, but they are less than 1 always. Okay, the next. Now comes the base current. How this base current comes into the picture? What is this? What is the direction? I gave IC and IB always same. But what is, how practically comes like in this one? See this one. This 100 previously let us suppose 10 electrons are there in n-type semiconductor. These 100 holes are coming here. These 100 holes are coming. Already 10 electrons are there. So what is going to happen? Out of these, 5 electrons will recombine with 5 holes. So 95 holes comes here. So initially there are 10 electrons are there, 5 electrons are recombined, there is a deficiency of 5 electrons. There is a deficiency of 5 electrons because of recombination. So immediately that 5 electrons are supplied by the base terminal. 5 electrons are going in this direction, means what is the actual direction of base current? So this is the reference direction, this is the actual direction, therefore both are in the opposite direction, therefore IB will be negative. Okay, so by changing the base doping level or base current, output current can be controlled. Therefore now, what is the, I will give the comparison between now, why we are going for diode. In a diode, there are two terminals are there, anode and cathode. Whatever the changes happened at the emitter terminal, anode terminal, will be reflected immediately at the cathode terminal, if it is forward bias. If it is reverse bias, the changes happened at the input side, at anode side, will not be at all reflected. So there is no controlling, either immediately will be reflected or not at all reflecting. So that is called, there is no isolation between emitter, anode and cathode, or fully isolation. It's not, there is no controlling. If you are coming for transistor, it's a three terminal semiconductor device, and here with the help of base we can control the output current irrespective of input current. Input current is very large, assume. Now what will do? Base current will increase it. Base current is increasing means the number of charge carriers receiving at the collector junction are going to be reduced. Therefore we are controlling or not. Okay? That means with the help of base we can control the output current. That is the significance of the transistor. We can control the output current in a transistor. In a diode we are not in a position to control the output current. That is called, that's why we are going for transistor. One of the reason. The second reason that we'll see it in the tomorrow session. Okay? When in some other case it comes, at that time I will explain the other reason for the going for a transistor. Okay? One of the thing is we can control the output current. We can, because with the help of a base. Now, the large signal gain alpha is given it as IPC by IE. This also can be written as output current instead of IPC, IE, IC by IE. And if you see, IC and IE are always in the opposite direction. So for that purpose, we'll take minus sign. Therefore, now it's minus of IC by IE. Okay, this is written as delta IC by delta IE. Change, instead of directly at one point we'll checking the change, this can be written as minus of IC2 minus IC1 by IE2 minus IE1 alpha. This is written as minus IC by IE. Assume input current is 0, that is emitter current is 0. If emitter current is 0, whether output current will be there? If input current is 0, whether output current will exist? Yes. Why? Collector base junction is reverse bias. Emitter base junction we are not applying any current, but collector base junction is reverse bias. Reverse bias means there will be some small current due to minority carriers, that is denoted as minus IC naught. Minus IC naught. This is written as minus alpha IE is equals to IC minus IC naught. This is IC equals to minus alpha IE plus IC naught. Okay, this is the expression for the output current for a previous figure. Whatever I have drawn in that one, the expression for output current is given as like this. Clear? Now, next comes if transistor is having three terminals, but for a, let us suppose from plugs, if you want to give something, if you want to take something from the plugs main, minimum number of terminals required are 2. If you want to put something into the mains, then also minimum terminals required are minimum, that's what I said. So, 2 terminals are required for input, 2 terminals are required for output. Total how many terminals you require? 4 terminals. But transistor is having only 3 terminals. But we have to make the 3 terminal semiconductor device into a 4 terminal semiconductor device. How you are going to make a 3 terminal semiconductor device into a 4 terminal semiconductor device? For that one, we are making one of the terminal common for both input and output. Therefore, it is called common base configuration. Common base configuration transistor. That's nothing but CB. It's also called as grounded base configuration. Grounded base configuration. The other one is common emitter configuration or grounded emitter configuration. This is denoted as CE. Then common collector configuration. This is denoted as grounded collector configuration. This is denoted as CC. Okay, so about this one in depth, we'll see it in the tomorrow session. Okay, a Pooja metal from Arian. Options of numerical you have just solved is okay, it's given options. And now once again, see, listen here, whether he asked for the hole concentration or electron concentration, first check it. Whether it's a P naught or N naught, based on that one it will change. My doubt it is not a P naught, it is N naught. Just check it based on that one. Initially I thought it's N naught, but it's, you said it's a P naught. Okay, that's why if it is a P naught, that answer is correct. If it is N naught, we have to solve it. Okay. So first check it whether it's a P naught or N naught, then okay. P naught means it has to be correct. Okay, P naught means it has to be correct. That's whatever we've done. N naught means we have to solve it. Next, Kirtana. Sir, please explain once again varector diode. A PN junction diode under reverse bias condition acts as a parallel plate capacitor given by epsilon A by W. Now, depletion layer. As the reverse voltage increases, width of the depletion increases. Width of the depletion layer increases, happens to increases. PN junction reverse bias, it acts as a transition capacitance, provides transition capacitance, acts as a parallel plate capacitor given by epsilon A by W. As the reverse voltage increases, the width of the depletion layer increases, CD decreases. Okay, that means the capacitance is changing. Therefore, we are indicating like this. Since capacitance is changing, we can use F equals to, let us suppose the one formula, F equals to 1 by 2 pi square root of L into C. C is changing, that means F is changing. So it is finds applications in tuner application, tuning purposes. Clear? As the reverse voltage changes, the capacitance offered by the diode is changing, that is called varector diode. Okay? So it finds applications in tuners. Clear, Kirtana? Okay. Thank you. That will see it in the next class. Thank you.